All right. Yeah, good morning. How are you? Doing all right? Okay. It's good to see you here. I want to share with you a couple things. We are going to be busy this week, and want to remind you, next week, first of all, we have a very short special call business meeting. We'll be looking and passing out. I think you already had a week to get the copies, but it'll be a job description for the music worship leader. And so we'll look at that and approve that next Sunday, and the team can continue its work. Two things for this week. You may not be aware of it, but World Changers, if you're a part of that, you already know. But if you have any questions, feel free to touch base with Ms. Doris this week. And we're going to be feeding the World Changers in Henderson starting Tuesday. And so we appreciate those of you that are being a part of that. Another biggie. Next week is fair. And on Tuesday, we are going to feed, as we always have. You said about 100 people? Okay. So on Tuesday, we're responsible for about 100 people to feed them. If you can, bring something, even if you haven't signed up, parentheses, bring something anyway, they'll eat it. And we need it here by 10:30 Tuesday morning, okay? And you can probably, if you're close to that, just drop it off out here in the fellowship hall area. If you're within a few minutes of that, even if it's warm, we'll be heading out with it. So 10:30 Tuesday, if you can bring some food for us to feed the people at the fair, they'll appreciate it. World Changers, mentioned that. So World Changers and Fair, pork chop sale. The next 3 weeks, the best 2 weeks, hopefully the first two Saturdays out of that, with a rain date worked in there. So the next two Saturdays, if weather permits, we'll be here in the parking lot with pork chops, ribeyes, and we'll also have pork burgers and also lemon shake-ups. Mr. Fought has done a great job on those. They're the best I've ever had. I don't like lemon shake-ups. I like his, so that tells you something. So we'll be here, and that will go to support our youth who are going to the camp in July. So be aware of that. If you can't be on one of them, you'll have two options in the next 3 weeks, hopefully the next two Saturdays, weather permitting. Finally, thank you. I'm just not good at corporate things where I'm the center of attention. They make me uncomfortable, but at the same time, I appreciate it. And so thank you for last Sunday. And it has been a great journey, and I'm sorry I made Doris's life so miserable Saturday trying to sneak all this stuff in and getting around me, and she couldn't do it. And I know that when Pastor Tim walks up and says, I need you in the back, I'm going, you either are foolish or desperate or there's something up, one of the three. And so anyway, thank you for all your love and outpouring of that. I appreciate it very much. Lastly, and most important, we hope that if you're here this morning for the first time, that you'll feel like you're just a part of the family when you leave. And so if you have not filled out a card in front of you, we'd appreciate that. Fill it out, drop in the offering plate a little bit later on, especially if there's a prayer concern or need. We'd love to be able to take care of that need for you. Stand up and welcome someone around you. It's good to see you back from Greece, brother. You know, on holidays like this, some people are gone elsewhere to be with their fathers, but some people are here. And so make sure you check around because you may see a few faces you don't normally and say hi to them, you know, love on them a little bit if they're not here normally, but they're here because this is where their dads are. So again, let's go to the Lord and worship by praying, and then we'll praise him in music. Jesus, thank you for the ability to celebrate Father's Day. So many things that a godly father will teach their children. Lord, all of us are here today with a realization that our dads are either with us physically. They may be with us in heart somewhere else. They can't be here today, or we can't be with them. Or they're with us in spirit because they're already in eternity. Whichever the case may be, thank you for the memories, the moments that we can think upon and remember. And Lord, if we have the privilege of building continual memories from here out for a while, we pray, Lord, that that might be what today is spent doing, building more memories. Jesus, thank you for loving us. Thank you for allowing us to have breath that you give us, and to acknowledge that as our Creator, we not only need you, but even more precious to you as we want you. And so thank you for the cross and the empty tomb. Our hope will always lie there. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's worship.
Good morning.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Just as you are to worship, come. Just as you are before your God, come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before. As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the God, the everlasting God. You do not, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like rise, and we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will.
thank you, Dad, for always being there for me and teaching me that nothing is impossible.
Thank you for never giving up on me, Dad. I appreciate it.
Thank you for being there, being at home. That really means a lot to me, so thank you for that.
Thank you, Dad, for always being just across town, no matter how far apart we are.
Thank you, Daddy, for teaching me right from wrong.
Dad, thanks for coaching softball all those years and being silly with me.
Dad, I want to thank you for making me become the man I've always wanted to become.
I just thank you that you're a dad that pointed me back to the Lord, and I'm grateful that you're in my life.
Thank you for giving me the confidence to know that I can do whatever I want to do.
Thanks, Dad, for teaching me never to give up.
Thank you, Dad, for teaching me unconditional love.
Thank my dad for showing me how to have a caring heart.
Thank you, Dad, for the times we've spent together.
Thank you for being a giving person.
Thank you, Daddy, for coming to every soccer game that I ever played.
Thanks for when it snowed for the first time on the ranch, how you built snowmen with me.
You taught me how to handle adversity.
You taught me to stand up for what I believe in.
You taught me how to drive.
You taught me how to throw that perfect spiral.
You taught me to love nature.
You taught me to always let my conscience be my guide.
You taught me to be a good husband.
You taught me to be a person of honor.
You taught me how to be a great father.
You taught me to have confidence in myself.
You taught me to love God and have lots of fun doing it.
You taught me to never, ever, ever give up.
You taught me how to survive in this crazy world.
You taught me that there's nothing I can't do.
Thanks, Dad.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dad.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Thank you.
God, thank you for these men that we look up to right here in our church family. And we also remember those who made an impact in our life who may be in heaven tonight, today. And we know how they're celebrating because they enjoy all of the privileges and the joys and the delights of heaven. But God, thank you so much for this instrument called Father. Someone to teach us right from wrong. Someone who's given us tough love, but consistently loved us and still does. Thank you for modeling that by giving up your son for all of us. We love you and we praise you and thank you for these fathers. In Christ's name, amen. Now let's everyone stand and let's worship.
Seated above and throned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind, God's only Son, perfect and spotless love. Never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. All awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, for you overcame. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one, he never sinned. Awesome and powerful forever. awesome and great is your name. You overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome.
Sing that again.
We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, for you overcame. Jesus, awesome and powerful forever, awesome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, for you overcame. Jesus, awesome and powerful forever, awesome.
I didn't intend to have that break because I didn't have my music organized, and Diane saved me from having a big blunder.
I didn't do very good
but
at it either.
But what it did was allow us to hear you sing, which is pretty incredible.
Yeah.
Thank y'all. Now, if I can get my other music up here. Amen.
Question in there. It says, "Are you Lord God Almighty?" And I always wondered, why do we have to ask that? And I just figured it out. We're asking that for ourselves. Is He Lord Almighty over you? That's why that question's in there. And so today, I just encourage you just to think about that question in your life and your finances. And gosh, just talking about it this morning, your kids' lives, which we have no control over. Are we letting God be Lord God Almighty in our life and take care of that stuff? So just bow with me, please. Father God, we just thank you for who you are, that you are Lord God Almighty, and that you're in control of everything. Help us when we forget that each and every day, Lord. We just thank you because you love us like we are, but you don't leave us there. You help us every day to try to be better, to be more like you. Father God, help us to give today and be joyful givers. Help us to be good stewards of what you've given us and use it in a way that pleases you. We thank you for your love and your mercy, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chain. We were made to be courageous.
Courageous, Lord, make us courageous.
Guys, we were made to be courageous. Are we always courageous? Of course not. Need to have the James Bond effect. Never let him see you bleed and always have an escape plan. Courageous. Come on, Dad. Mary's parents are letting him go to the party. Why can't you? We're going down to the skate park. I'll see you later. No. You're going to do your homework. And I don't know who is down at the skate park. Who is it? Well, you know, it's James and Bullfrog and whoever else. A bunch of weird people that you've never met before. Why don't you have them come to the house so we can get to know them? Oh, come on, Dad. You're too square. There's no way. You're just not cool. They wouldn't get it. I can't tell you how many times I've had my kids, or maybe you've experienced this, where they want to do something that their parents are allowing their friends to do, but you're saying no. Kind of reminds me of Isaiah, who said, I think, as for me and my household, we will what? Serve the Lord. I don't care what everyone else is doing. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Now, there's two ways to do that. You can be demanding and go, these are my rules and my house and my walls and my food and my clothes, and you're going to do exactly what I tell you to do. Or there's a better way, being consistent in your discipline. Loving discipline is important. Standing for what you believe and expressing tough love sometimes, but you can still be loving and graceful. Today we honor our fathers, and that's a good thing. I don't think dads get a lot of respect these days. I read a story about a doting father who used to sing his children to sleep. He even learned a few lullabies to lend some variety to the task. And this way, this is something he could do at night to help his wife out. And he kept up this task until one night he overheard one of the older children say to her younger sister, if you pretend to be asleep, he'll stop singing. And that was the end of the lullabies. Garrison Keillor, on his book, Writer's Almanac, on National Public Radio, said that Father's Day goes back to a Sunday morning in May of 1909 when a woman named Sonora Smart Dodd was sitting in a church in Spokane, Washington, listening to a Mother's Day message. And she thought about her father, who had raised her and her siblings after her mother died in childbirth. And she thought that fathers should get recognized as well. She asked the minister of the church if he would deliver a sermon honoring fathers on her father's birthday, which was coming up in June. And the minister did. And the tradition of Father's Day caught on, though a little slowly. Mother's Day became an official holiday in 1914. I did not know this, but Father's Day did not become a real holiday until June of 1972. Wow. And even today, of mothers and fathers, Mother's Days are the busiest days for florists and restaurants and used to be long distance companies. Now cell phone towers are being used and you can't get online on Mother's Day. And so all the attention is paid to all the moms, and rightfully so. What I'm going to tell you, some of us dads, we have some work cut out for ourselves as well. I like what Oscar Wilde said once. Fathers should never be seen nor heard. I thought that was about kids. He said, fathers should not be seen nor heard. That is the only proper basis for family life. Again, you model your father, your experiences to your kids. Let's turn to Mark's Gospel, chapter 4. This is an interesting parallel. You know, it's a parable, rather. A story was what that means, with a spiritual emphasis. Would you stand with me in the honor of reading God's Holy Word? Jesus also said, the kingdom of God is like a farmer who scatters seed on the ground, night and day, while he is asleep or awake. The seed sprouts and grows, but he does not understand how it happens. The earth produces the crops on its own. First, the leaf blade pushes through, the heads of wheat are formed, and finally the grain ripens. And as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle, for the harvest time has come. Let's pray. God, what happens in a moment, that sometimes it feels like an eternity, and then we blink and it's past us? Being a dad. There are lots of dads, but you're calling us to be fathers. And it's never too late. Whatever we've done in the past, we can correct for the future. We remember the lessons we learned from our dads, and we try to hand those down. But God, we thank you for who you are in our life. And teach us this idea of scattering seed and allowing you to grow it. And we give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, Jesus is not talking about necessarily fatherhood in this passage, but this is the very first area in which he participate in talking about the coming of the kingdom of God. And it's this idea of raising children. Raising good children is like scattering seed upon the ground. Now, we know the biblical reference, right? Sometimes the seed is scattered on the ground, and sometimes it doesn't take root. Why? Because it lands on hard soil, because it lands on not a fertile ground. It doesn't land where it's rich. It lands where it's hard. And so, you know, if it's on pavement or concrete or hard dirt, it's not going to likely grow. Has to be cultivated, has to be sold. Even I am not an agricultural expert. No, ground has to be tilled or chewed up a little bit so that it has a chance to grow. Several years ago, our front yard had some spots, and I decided not to read the directions. I just decided to get some grass seed, and I just kind of scattered it in the spot. And then I did water it, and then God watered it from above, and I waited. And I waited, and I waited some more, and guess what? No grass. So I went back to where I got it. It was like a Rural King or something like that. And I said, I want my money back. This seed did not grow one bit of seed of grass. Sir, did you follow the directions? What directions? On the back of the bag. You have to dig up the ground, plant the seed, and you've got to cover it with some kind of a, you know, like a straw or something to keep the moisture. Oh, you mean there's more that I have to do? Why is it that every time I go to Lowe's or Home Depot or Rural King or even Walmart these days, you got to buy something and then you got to go home and work it? You can't just let someone do it for you. And that's the whole point, right? It takes a little bit of work. And the same thing spiritually. We can't just show emotion. We can't just do discipline. Our kids have to know we love them. As I've often said, people don't care what you know until they know that you care. And so the same thing with our children. Author Ken Canfield says, there are no guarantees in either raising kids or planting seed. And that is true. A farmer can do everything that's right, do all the right things, and still lose a crop. So can parents. The farmer can till the ground at the right time, put in the right seed, do what I didn't do, and irrigate and fertilize according to the textbook, but that does not guarantee a crop. Some of you have learned the hard way that there are no guarantees. But generally, if we have done the best that we can in planting and nurturing the seed, which are our children, God will reward us with children that we can be proud of. So I want to begin here on this Father's Day. Fathers are important. It doesn't always work out, of course, as many young women today are doing a superb and difficult job of raising their children without a dad. But where possible, having dad around can make a real positive difference. William Raspberry, a syndicated writer with the Washington Post, in a recent column, he made this analogy. He said, some years ago, South Africa's game managers had to figure out what to do about the elephant herd at Kruger National Park. The herd was growing well beyond the ability of the park to sustain it. And so they decided to transport some of the herd to a nearby game park. A dozen years later, however, several of the young male elephants, now teenagers, that had been transported to the game park began to attack the park's herd of white rhinos, an endangered species. They used their trunks to throw sticks at the rhinos, chased them over long hours and great distances, and stomped to death a tenth of the herd for all no non-discernible reason, just because they were there. And park managers decided they had no choice but to kill some of the worst of the teenager elephants. And they had killed five of them when someone came up with another bright idea. They brought in some of the mature male elephants still residing in the Kruger Park and hoped that the bigger, stronger males could bring the younger ones under control. And to the delight of the park officials, it worked. The big bulls quickly established the natural hierarchy and reduced the violent behavior of the younger bulls. The new discipline, it turned out, was not just a matter of size or intimidation. The young bulls actually started following the big daddies around. And whatever the big guys did, the younger teenagers started following. Learning from them proper elephant conduct, the assaults on the white rhinos ended abruptly. Kids will do what they see you doing. I was only called to the principal twice in my entire life. Never from the time I was in first grade through even today, still in school, I've never been called to the principal's office for something I've done. One time, Shelby used a cell phone in high school and was not allowed in school at Harrison High School. And so they called me as a parent and said, you have to come and get your daughter's cell phone so we can have a discussion. And I was nervous as a cat as I sat there watching and listening to the principal, and I thought I was in trouble. The only other time that I was ever in the principal's office is when the principal of Kyle's school called me. Mr. Lettingham, where's Mrs. Lettingham? Well, she's a teacher in another school, and so I'm available. What can I do? I need you to come to the office as soon as possible. I was like, oh, great. What did he do? Well, just 2 days prior to that, we had decided to go out as father and son, and we decided to play 9 holes of golf. And we had drank a lot of water. And there were no restroom facilities, so we went behind a tree. And we took care of nature's business. And I taught him how to do that. What I didn't teach him to do was to do the same thing in public on the playground on Tuesday. To which I was called in the principal's office and said, please tell your son that's not appropriate. Be careful what you do with your children. Whatever you model, they will pick up on. Same thing with these elephants. You know, I learned that most dads do the best they can, and we're proud to be able to honor them, and fathers are important. A reliable father can do wonders in the lives of his children. A reliable father can do wonders in the lives of his children. And many of us have observed this in our own families. A thoughtful and dependable dad can have a wondrous impact on the lives of his offspring. I love reading stories about sports figures. Football fans know that there's a father who is rightfully celebrated. His name is Archie Manning, former NFL quarterback, a successful businessman, husband and father of three sons. Two of them also played in the NFL, Peyton Manning and Eli Manning. He's still playing, Eli's still playing, although not very well in New York. Even more important, all three Manning boys are men of character. Archie claims that one of the greatest joys in life was the relationship with his sons. All the Manning boys praise their father for being actively involved in their lives. They describe their dad as being loving and supportive, and Archie recalls that his sons were growing up, he made sure to spend lots of time with them as much as he could. One reason that Archie Manning has been so deliberate in building a relationship with his sons is because he lost that chance with his own dad. Archie Manning was only 19 years old when his father committed suicide, and he determined that he would never waste an opportunity to show his sons how much he loved them, and he didn't. I just think it's inspiring, don't you? When any man takes his responsibilities at home seriously, it's inspiring. We celebrate sports heroes as dads only because their example sometimes makes us want to do better. Sometimes they're so poor at being a dad that we like, when we grow up, we're going to do better. It's an old story, but it's still a good story. Baseball pitcher named Tim Burke in 1985, that's his card. That's his boyhood dream came true, and he became a Major League Baseball player for the Montreal Expos. After 4 years in the minors, he was finally given a chance to play in the big leagues. He had finally made the big dance. And he quickly proved to be worth his salt, setting a record for the most relief appearances by a rookie player that year. But along the way, Tim and his wife, Christine, adopted four children with very special needs, two daughters from South Korea, a handicapped son from Guatemala, and another son from Vietnam. All of the children were born with very serious illnesses or defects. Neither Tim nor Christine was prepared for the tremendous demands of what it would take to raise that family. And the grueling schedule of the Major League Baseball season, Tim was seldom around to help out. So basically it was left to his wife. So in 1993, only 3 months after signing a $600,000 contract, that's how long he was in the league, he had a contract with the Cincinnati Reds, and Tim Burke decided to retire from baseball. And when pressed by reporters to explain his decision, why he would be retiring early, he simply said, "Baseball is going to do just fine without me, but I'm the only father my children have." And he walked away from the game that he loved so much. Of course, you don't have to be a great sports hero to be a great dad. There are men all over the world who are seeking to model what it means to be a Christian dad. I don't know if you've ever seen Hotel Rwanda, but it is a wonderful movie and is a true story. Maybe you know it. This guy, Paul, try to spell his right, say his name right, Rusesabagina, but I don't know if that's right. In 1994, Hutu militants began a brutal assault against their Tutsi neighbors. More than 1 million people were murdered by the Hutu. In the midst of the slaughter, over 1,200 desperate people took refuge in Paul's hotel. Daily, Paul faced down armed troops who wanted to invade the hotel and kill every living person there. Paul's courage and his determination in protecting the refugees in his hotel was so remarkable that they made that movie, Hotel Rwanda, about this event. Paul credits two heroes with giving him the courage he needed in that critical moment in time. One was his father, and the other one was Nelson Mandela. His father had been well respected in the community. He was a wise man. He always told the truth. When there were disputes in the community, the elders would call on Paul's father to mediate the differences. He was so honest that if one party in a dispute was lying, they often confessed their lie as soon as they saw Paul's father. His noble character made him so influential in the community. Nelson Mandela, former president of South Africa, inspired Paul because he used nonviolence and communication to bring about peace between enemies. And Paul claims that the examples of his father and Nelson Mandela inspired him as he faced murderous mobs during the Hutu attacks. A great dad can have the power of influence. Many moms are just as courageous. Still, it is true that a determined father can do wonders in the lives of their children or grandchildren. There are no guarantees, but when a determined man or woman plants a seed and takes the necessary steps to nurture that seed, miracles can occur. Of course, the love of any parent is but a pale reflection of the love of God. God is the ultimate sower of good seed in our world. We would not know how to live or love if God had not first loved us. So in his book, Disappointment with God, writer Philip Yancey relates a touching story from his own life. He said one time on a visit to his mother, who had been widowed years earlier, they spent the afternoon going through old pictures, just reminiscing and going through boxes of old photos. And they found a certain photo of him as an 8-month-old baby, and it caught his eye. The picture was a little tattered and torn and bent. It looked too banged up to be worth keeping, so he asked her, with so many other pictures of him at the same age, why she had kept that one. And Yancey continues, my mother explained to me that she kept the photo as a memento because during my father's illness, it had been fastened to his iron lung. During the last 4 months of his life, Yancey's father lay straight on his back, completely paralyzed by polio at the age of 24, encased from the neck down in a huge cylinder-like tube breathing unit. With his two young sons banned from the hospital due to the severity of his illness, he had asked his wife for a picture of her and the two boys because he was unable to move even his head. The photos had to be jammed between the metal knobs so that they hung there within view above him. It was the only thing he could see were his kids. And the last 4 months of his life were spent looking at the faces that he loved. And Philip Yancey goes on to say, I have often thought of that crumpled photo, for it is one of the few links connecting me to a stranger who was my father I did not know. Someone I have no memory of, no sensory knowledge of, spent all day, every day thinking of me, devoting himself to me, loving me. The emotions I felt when my mother showed me that crumpled photo is the very same emotions I felt that February night in a college dorm room when I first believed in a God of love. Someone is there, I realized. Someone is there who loves me. It was starting to feeling a wild hope, a feeling of new and overwhelming that it seemed fully worth risking my life on. Philip Yancey is one of the most important Christian writers living today. Obviously, his mother's influence was powerful, but his father's love, even though he cannot remember his own father, helped him get off to a good start. And as he would be the first to acknowledge, any parent's love, regardless of how intense that it is but, again, a pale reflection of the love of God that has for each of us. I hope that we understand that God has a photo of you. That's what Max Lucado once said in one of his books. Did you know that he said God has a photo of you on your refrigerator? I wish I had everybody's pictures in my office that I had on my refrigerator. I have my grandchildren, and I have the Shouse children. And I have Dallas and Paisley on my refrigerator that I pray for every single day. Every day. Before I get anything at all out of the fridge, I lift those kids in my prayers. Fathers, like mothers, are all important. A reliable father can have an amazing impact on his children. But no matter how much our dad loves us or our mom, there is someone who will always love us more. God gave his only son on our behalf. So let's honor fathers on this day. Let's praise our Heavenly Father, who is the source of all of life and all of love.
Dad, do you love Mom?
I do.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, do you love my brother?
Connor? I do.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, do you love God?
Yeah.
How much?
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, do you love me? Dad.
I do.
How much? I already know.
Gobs and gobs.
Dad, how much is a gob?
Well, let me put it like this. Your favorite color is yellow. And when you eat those Nutter Butter cookies, you always scrape the peanut butter out of the middle and you secretly feed it to the dog because you think the dog deserves a treat too. At nighttime, I know before you go to bed, you always pull your Barbies all together because you don't want them to be lonely. And sometimes when you get a little nervous, you bat your eyes like this. They get really, really, really fast. But when you're happy and when you're excited, you always twirl your hair right beside your ear. And you love your mama's red earrings. And you always seem to eat your green beans one at a time. You see, my love, I notice you. And I love being your daddy. And I will always be here for you. Even on your best days, even on your worst days, your daddy loves you and will always be here for you. And that, my dear, that's what a gob is.
I gob you too, Daddy.
So just in case you were wondering, I love you gobs and gobs. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for loving us that way. More than gobs and gobs. More than we could really even understand or comprehend. It's unfathomable how much you love us. There are no words to really express that. The ultimate gift, of course, was your Son, who you loved, and you said, whom you were well pleased with. God, help us to really be good dads, to be the first to offer forgiveness, to be the last in line, to be the first to be there when someone's hurting, and just be consistent. Thank you, God, for being that kind of Father to us, a Heavenly Father who cares for us, who shows and showed us what love is. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.